This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Aloha and Happy New Year, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Pauline Shukmakchian, your host for two shows on ThinkTech Hawaii for a couple of months. One is Outside In every Wednesday at 2 p.m. and the other is We Like the 1% every Thursday at 11 a.m. My guest today is Dr. Yaron Brook, chairman of the Ayn Rand Institute and host of the Yaron Brook Show. Yaron, you're on ThinkTech Hawaii. Happy New Year.
Aloha and Happy New Year.
Thank you very much. How are you doing there in Puerto Rico?
I'm doing well. Just been here a few days and things are looking good, so I'm excited.
Great, great. So we have a lot to cover in terms of Rand and her work and her writings and her ideas. And you, even though you're one of my rare two-part guests I'll be having for these next couple of months, I'd like to just start, before we get into Rand and her work, a little bit about yourself. So could you please give us a little bit of a background about Yaron?
Sure. I was born in Israel, and like most Israelis, when I was young, I was a good socialist. And until I read at the age of 16, Atlas Shrugged, and Atlas Shrugged really changed my life and turned me into a real capitalist and a real advocate for individualism and reason and rational egoism. And I landed up getting in, serving in the Israeli military, getting an engineering degree, an MBA, a PhD in finance, moved to the US in 1987. And since 2000, I've been doing what I love to do, which is advocate for the ideas that I first learned about in Atlas Shrugged, the ideas of objectivism, the ideas of Ayn Rand.
And I read Atlas Shrugged about 25 years ago, so it's been a while, but that's not the first classic work she's associated with. She's known first for The Fountainhead, and then more popularly at the moment, Atlas Shrugged, because it's influenced a lot of entrepreneurs and business individuals. So maybe you want to talk about a little bit about her fictional writings before we get into her nonfiction works, which is the philosophy of objectivism. So let's start with the fun part, which is the fictional work, which everybody seems to like. Everybody loves Atlas Shrugged, and it's a very influential book, wouldn't you say?
Yes, it's hugely influential. Atlas Shrugged, if you ask, I think, Fortune 500 CEOs, what is the book that's influenced them the most? Atlas Shrugged will be in their top three, almost all of them. So it really has been, if you look at entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley, it's a dominant book in terms of the influence. Not necessarily they agree with the book. This is true of the CEOs. It's not that they agree with the book, but it inspired them. It inspired them to become entrepreneurs. It inspired them to do and work hard and produce and create and innovate and do all the things you need to do to be a successful entrepreneur. So it's definitely been a massive inspiration to successful people, primarily in business, but really in all walks of life. I mean, you'll find doctors, you'll find Hollywood stars of all people who've been greatly influenced by Atlas Shrugged. And of course, by The Fountainhead, her second most famous book, the book she wrote before Atlas Shrugged, which is a book about integrity, about individualism, and about aesthetic, artistic integrity. And indeed, it's a book that's loved by many artists. There was just a staging, a play version of The Fountainhead produced by a very well-known Dutch filmmaker in New York just a few weeks ago. Now, I don't know if it was any good, but it was a four-hour play sold out every night in New York City and by a very famous, relatively avant-garde Dutch filmmaker. And it shows you kind of the universality and the popularity of her works all over the world. The play is actually touring right now. But the book has inspired many, many young people. It is read widely among high school students. It's indeed very popular among AP English literature classes in the United States.
Yes, and that's where I heard about her in the first instance. And we've had this conversation before when we've met that I don't necessarily agree with everything she's written. It would be a little bit strange if you did agree with everything someone wrote, because you don't want to be a devotee. You want to find arguments that you agree with. And then there are some things I don't understand in her writing. And I think that's the case with you yourself, even though you are the chairman of the Institute that represents her work.
Oh, I mean, I would say that I agree with her philosophy. I agree, I'm not a philosopher and I don't have any qualms with anything she wrote qua philosophy. I might disagree here and there with a certain application, but fundamentally, I agree with her ideas. And I believe I'm an advocate for her ideas.
Okay. And yes, I agree most with the pro-individual, pro-entrepreneurship, and pro-capitalism stance she takes, particularly in Atlas Shrugged. So let's move away from the fictional works and just touch upon, give a little introduction to her philosophy, which is influenced by Aristotelian thought. So she came up with this philosophy known as objectivism. And how does that differ from Aristotle? Does she go off from Aristotle, or is it basically offspring of Aristotle?
The development in Aristotle, but it's a lot of new content. There's a lot of philosophical content that Aristotle did not have. I mean, he was 2,000 plus years ago. A lot has happened in the world. There's a lot for us to have learned over the last 2,000 years from reality to articulate, I think, a fuller, more complete philosophy than Aristotle could. We've had the scientific revolution, we had the age of reason, the Enlightenment. There's a lot of human knowledge has been accumulated over the last 2,000 plus years. So to start off with, he agrees with Aristotle basically in the metaphysics. Reality is what it is. A is A. The law of identity, the law of causality, hold, is articulated by Aristotle. So the world is not created by some external power that manipulates it on a regular basis, and the world is not created by us, by our consciousness. It is there. And then we have the tool, human consciousness, more fundamentally human reason, we have the tool to know reality. And Rand held that the only means for knowing reality, our only tool of cognition, and our basic means of survival is our capacity to reason.
Yes.
And reason is efficacious.
Yes, and one of the problems with this, especially in contemporary society that I think you have to deal with and the Institute has to deal with, is that there is a shift away from the use of reason to emotions.
Yes.
So you have your work cut out for you.
Yes. In our view, and in Rand's view, is a disaster because it is a shift away from our means of knowledge, from our means of cognition, to a derivative, which is an emotion. An emotion is a derivative thought. It is not a primary. It does not teach us about the world. It teaches about ourselves, about our response to the world. What we want cognition for, what we want our senses and our reason for, is to know reality, is to teach us about the world in which we need to survive. So reason is our means of survival. And when we shift away from reason to emotion, we hurt ourselves, we hurt our prospects in life, we hurt the prospects for society to thrive. It really is a disastrous shift, as we've seen throughout the 20th century and the 21st century. So she held the primacy of reason. Knowledge is not implanted in us. It's not received through mystical revelation. It is not received through emotion. The only way to achieve knowledge is by use of the human mind. It's by reasoning. It's by using your reasoning faculty.
And she refers.
And then, of course, yeah, go ahead.
Yes, she refers to this as rational self-interest. That's one of the tools you can use.
Well, I was going to move into self-interest. And then, so actually, that was a matter of physics and epistemology. And then in ethics, she says, who reasons? Only the individual reasons. There is no group consciousness. There is no group thinking any more than there is group eating or a group stomach. There's only an individual's mind. So only an individual can think. And morally, for Ayn Rand, the individual is the entity that matters. So morality is about the individual figuring out, pursuing the values and virtues necessary for his flourishing, for his happiness. So using reason to pursue happiness and flourishing. So this is, again, a little bit of Aristotle, the pursuit of eudaimonia, the pursuit of individual flourishing. Ayn Rand anchors that in rational self-interest, in a morality of rational self-interest, and in a whole set of values and virtues. So what she rejects is the conventional morality that says the purpose of life is to sacrifice for others. The purpose of life is other people's happiness, not your own. She rejects that as evil. And she rejects the idea that the only thing left is then exploiting other people. So she says your purpose in life is to pursue your own happiness, your own flourishing, neither sacrificing yourself to other people, nor sacrificing other people to yourself.
And for those who have never read any of Rand's works, which one would you suggest that they start with? Which one do you think would have the most comprehensive effect in terms of her thinking?
Well, I think the most comprehensive effect would be Atlas Shrugged, but I would recommend starting with The Fountainhead. I think it's a nice way in. It's a more personal book. More people respond positively to it because it's less political. So it's less going to trigger people on the politics. And it's going to lead people, it's going to lead them with a discussion on individualism, on aesthetic integrity. And I think things that people are more open to, and then only go to Atlas Shrugged where the political, moral, societal implications for the whole philosophy are articulated.
And once they're ready to go to the next level, they can go to ayanrand.org, is that correct? And they can, there's a whole bunch of free courses and lectures that are on offer on there.
There's a lot of content at ayanrand.org itself, and then if you click on the tab called Campus, there are whole courses on her novels, on her nonfiction, on her philosophy. And of course, people should continue after Atlas Shrugged reading some of her nonfiction, things like The Virtue of Selfishness, which is a wonderful book, or Capitalism, the Unknown Ideal, or Philosophy, Who Needs It, books that contain essays, important essays on her philosophical ideas.
And how would you say is the reaction from people who have done the courses or people who have attended your various events like the OCON that you have on an annual basis? What seems to be the reaction to her work primarily?
Well, I mean, it would classify it into two. So people who attend OCON, Abbey Conference, or people who listen to courses are typically people who've already read her books and who are already probably favorably inclined because now they're investing in coming to a conference, they're investing in spending a lot of time and effort in it. So it, those people, you know, they love the courses and they love the conference because to them, it's immersing themselves in these ideas and also experiencing these ideas with other people who share these ideas with them.
Okay, wonderful, Yaron. I'm just going to pause for a break and then we'll be right back to talk a little bit more about rational self-interest and selfishness.
Sounds good.
We'll be right back after this quick break.
This is Think Tech Hawaii, raising public awareness.
Aloha, my name is Mark Shklov. I am the host of Think Tech Hawaii's Law Across the Sea. Law Across the Sea comes on every other Monday at 11 a.m. Please join us. I like to bring in guests that talk about all types of things that come across the sea to Hawaii. Not just law, love, people, ideas, history. Please join us for Law Across the Sea. Aloha.
Aloha, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to our discussion with Dr. Yaron Brook, chairman of the Ayn Rand Institute. And Yaron, are you still there? Yes, you are.
I am. I'm still here.
Now, we're going to get into some of the talks you give. Mainly, you give lectures at universities. Is that correct?
That's right.
So they're for university students, because I think when we had this discussion at one point, it's a little easier to influence younger people because it's a bit like the military. After a certain age, you can't influence somebody because their personality has been fully formed. So
it's not about influencing them. I think generally we are open during our youth, from 16 to maybe 30. We're open to new ideas. We're experimenting. We're testing ideas out. We want to be independent. We want to think of ourselves. We separate ourselves from our parents. We go to college to absorb and to learn and to engage with new ideas. I think after age 30, we kind of settle. We've already accepted the ideas. These are the ideas that are going to guide our life. Whether we know explicitly or not, we go get a job, we have a family, and life becomes a routine, and we're not as open to radical ideas, new ideas, to being provoked. And I think there's certainly a certain calcification almost that happens in the brain that prevents new ideas from penetrating after a certain age.
And the other thing that you make very clear in a lot of your talks is that this is, in fact, a lot of hard work to develop oneself as an individual, because I think Maslow's hierarchy, Maslow said that only 2% of the world is actually self-actualized. So it is actually a lot of hard work, and you do emphasize that in your lectures. Because let's face it, most people are sort of lazy. And it's an easier option for people to pick their nose, scratch their ass, and fart on the couch in front of the television. So it is quite a lot of hard work to do this self-actualization.
I mean, I tell audience that being self-interested, taking your life seriously, trying to be the best that you can be at living, is hard work because it requires thinking. If you had to boil down Ayn Rand's ethics, Ayn Rand's morality, to one word, it would be think. He would say, to have a good life, to pursue the right values that are going to lead to happiness and prosperity and flourishing, think. and unfortunately, most people find thinking hard work. And they're not used to it, and we don't train them in school to think. We're not good at critical thinking. We don't train people in critical thinking, but that is the most important activity in life.
It's like what George Carlin said, that universities are not there to teach people to think. They're there to create obedient workers.
Unfortunately, that's true. And you have to remember the public educational system was first embraced by Germany during the 19th century under Bismarck. And the whole point of public education under Bismarck was to train people to be good, obedient workers. And I think we still have the same public educational system today that is basically trying to train people to be good, obedient workers instead of to train people to be thinkers and therefore innovators and creators and entrepreneurs, which is what we really need them to be.
Yes, and that's quite a shame. And one of the questions I wanted to ask you is that as I mentioned, I don't agree with everything Rand wrote. I don't agree with everything the Institute pursues. And one of the things, and this is not because I necessarily agree with Trump or anything like that that is political, but the Institute seems to be rather critical of Trump's presidency. And I'm just wondering, not to be cheeky or anything, isn't he in a way pursuing his own self-interest? I mean, what's wrong with what he's doing?
Because No, I mean, Trump wouldn't know his self-interest if it bit him. you need to be a thinker to pursue your self-interest. You need to be a rational thinker. You need to be somebody who can think long-term, who can conceptualize. Trump is not a thinker. Trump is an emoter. Trump is an emotional guy. He's got very low self-esteem, in my view. He gets upset at anybody criticizing him. Just see the firestorm right now against Steve Bannon over quotes in the book. I mean, he can't stand criticism. He can't stand people speaking back to him. He is not a conceptual being fully in the sense of an Ayn Rand self-interested character. So no, I don't think Trump's being self-interested any more than I think that anybody pursuing their emotions is self-interested.
Well, we've had this discussion once before when we met as well, where it's very emotional in America, his presidency, but I actually don't think it really matters who the president is, because everybody who pursues politics, almost everyone, I think, in history as well, it has to be a sort of a narcissist. That's part of the personality profile of somebody who pursues a career in politics, whether they were a businessman before or whatever. So I remember sometimes you get the question in your audience, what do you think of Trump? And you very clearly said that on Think Tech as well. But I remember on one occasion you answered, you replied with, well, he's just somebody who wants to see his name in gold. And I'm just wondering, along the lines of Ayn Rand, is there, I mean, who's to say one individual's pursuit of self-interest is wrong? I mean, who's the person who creates that? What is rational self-interest?
The standard is reality. And if you see somebody acting based on emotion, I think you can argue, and Ayn Rand would argue, that that person is not pursuing their self-interest, because emotion is not going to lead you to achieving your values and to achieving success. That is metaphysically and epistemologically true. So yes, you can evaluate people and say, that person is pursuing their self-interest and that person is not. That person is sacrificing, that person is self-destructive. For example, I can tell you that people who lie do not achieve happiness. Lying is not a strategy to be happy. Donald Trump lies all the time. Now, I wouldn't care, typically. If he wants to put his name up on big buildings and he wants to do this thing, I wouldn't care. The problem is, once he becomes president, he has a disproportionate impact on my life, right?
So Does he?
Real estate developer, I really don't care about Donald Trump one way or the other. If you'd asked me 2 or 3 years ago, what do I think about Donald Trump? I would have said, I don't think of him. That's a quote from Ayn Rand, but I don't think of him. But now that he's president, unfortunately, I have to think of him. And what I see is not good. What I see is distressing. What I see is somebody who's going to do more damage than good to the country. Now, I agree with you. Presidents are not that important, any one presidency.
Because
but
there's
Donald
always...
Trump is yeah. one more step in the direction of more authoritarianism, bigger government, and an American public that is dumbing itself down, which is a scary idea.
Well, it's been like that for a few decades now. So, unfortunately, yes, it's going in that direction. And what you're trying to do with the Institute and promotion of Rand's work is to try to help reverse that that situation, which we'll go into in a little bit more in depth tomorrow, on tomorrow's show on We Like the 1%. So you touched upon the issue of happiness, and one of the things that you make clear and some of your colleagues make clear in the Institute is that it's up to each and every individual to be happy, right? Nobody else can make you happy, not really.
Nobody else can make you happy. It's your responsibility. It's your moral responsibility. That's the purpose of ethics, is to study the virtues and values necessary for human happiness. I mean, happiness is your responsibility, but it's not like, yeah, do whatever you want to do.
It's not
it
hedonism.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's
they
not hedonism.
Principles. Just like yeah. there's good diet, there's good food, and there's poison. The same in life, the same in spiritual values. There are things that will lead you towards happiness, and there are things that will lead you towards self-destruction and misery. And what ethics should teach you, and what Ayn Rand's ethics tries to teach you, is the values and virtues that lead to happiness. And then it's your responsibility to embrace those values, to live them, and to achieve a happy, successful life.
And you can run off some of those values here on the show. I think you usually mention...
I think the most important value or in virtue is reason and rationality. That is the pursuit of thinking, you know, a pursuit of facts, your commitment to facts, 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 no matter what your emotions tell you, no matter what other people tell you. So independence, you know, rationality, independence, productiveness, really taking care of yourself, working, having a career, pride, gaining self-esteem, which is a requirement for happiness, real self-esteem, not the kind where you give a ribbon to everybody, but self-esteem that comes from achieving something. So it's about honesty and integrity. So those and justice, treating people the way they deserve. So it's those kind of virtues, rational virtues, virtues that originate from reason, from what it takes to live a good life. What does reality require of human beings in order for them to be successful?
And just in the run-up to the continuation of this discussion we're going to have tomorrow on the We Like the 1% show at 11 a.m. Hawaiian time, could you kindly explain to the 99% out there how billionaires are created? How are they made, Yaron? Is it by magic?
Do they just pull money? The only way to become a billionaire, if you're doing it legally and if you're doing it in a free
assuming it's legal,
is by offering a value to hundreds of millions of people, and that the hundreds of millions of people are willing to pay for that value more than it costs you to produce it, so that you make a profit hundreds of millions of times over. That's how you become a billionaire. So you sell a product over and over and over again. Why? Because it's making the lives of everybody who buys it better. Otherwise, they wouldn't buy it. People don't buy an iPhone for $500 because they're going to suffer. People buy an iPhone for $500 because they believe the iPhone is worth more to them than $500. So Apple is making hundreds of millions of people better off every single day while it makes billions of dollars.
So that is why it's important to be pro-entrepreneurial, pro-individual, because it's the other people who are making this person rich. It's only when you come to more abstract concepts of creation of money, that's what seems to bother most people, because they don't understand it, because the more abstract the method of making money is, the more people despise it. Is that correct?
The only people who make money abstractly are politicians and the Federal Reserve, who print it like crazy in bits. They don't even print the paper anymore.
Yes.
But for you and me, and for entrepreneurs out there, and for billionaires out there, the only way they make money is by offering a product that people are happy to buy because it makes their lives better.
And it also harmed them to some extent. And we'll go into this tomorrow, but Steve Jobs, Bill Bowerman of Nike, you talk about suffering. I mean, there is a lot of suffering involved in entrepreneurship, that the masses, they're just buying the sneakers and the phone. Well,
yeah, I mean, I wouldn't call it suffering. It's investment, it's hard work.
Yeah, well, in Bill Bowerman's case, it was severe nerve damage.
You know, these guys work very, very hard and are rewarded well for it.
Yeah, and they deserve that money, because one billionaire said money is the way of keeping score, right?
Yes, but it's the way of keeping score about how much value you've created in the world out there. Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Yaron. We're going to continue this discussion tomorrow, and I'll see you at 11 a.m. Hawaiian time. Thank you very much for being a guest on the show, and thank you all for listening to Outside In. See you tomorrow on We Like the 1%.